But anyway, so as we have been explaining, the training is based on repetition. Okay, and what will eventually distinguish the calligrapher is the ability to create new and successful compositions. Can you tell us what a classical calligrapher produces and different types of supports that they use?
Yeah, so actually I think one of the questions in today's world, most of you have probably gone to calligraphy exhibits and visited museums and you've been to different events, and you probably, actually, what do you think a classical calligrapher today produces today? Any ideas?
Quran,
all right. What else? See, it's actually very interesting to me that
I see lots of calligraphy murals, actually.
All right, calligraphy murals, like street art, you mean?
Yes.
Paintings. All right, yeah, paintings.
We saw here over the summer something called graffiti calligraphy.
All right, graffiti calligraphy, you see? This is really interesting.
Light art.
Yeah, light art. All right, yes. So these are all related to the letters in Arabic script, but they are not calligraphy. So when I say a classical calligrapher today, it is definitely not a street artist or light artist or so on. I mean, these are all very interesting art forms in the contemporary art field, but a classical calligrapher doesn't do anything like this. As we mentioned, you study for 7 years, and this long process is actually to write the sacred word. So you will, when you mentioned Quran, obviously that's mostly what calligraphers did at the beginning. You have Qurans, then you have maybe administrative documents, then you have calligraphy that was going to be applied onto different supports and different architectural surfaces. But then you have a very interesting development, because obviously now to write a Quran would be extremely expensive. It takes a very long time. In this modern world, it's not so easy to just put everything aside and just write the Quran and earn a living at the same time. So what you have is an introduction of something very interesting, which is what we call the calligraphy panel. We say leoha, leoh in Arabic. And this is actually, it starts at the beginning of the 17th century, and it's when the calligrapher stops, they never stop, we still have calligraphers producing Qurans today, but they start also to make calligraphy with a larger kalam on paper and to mount it for it to be displayed and hung up on the wall. So this is where calligraphy starts becoming not only an art of the book, but also an art that you can contemplate from a certain distance and it's hung. Yes?
Is that what's in the Museum of Islamic Art in Doha?
In Doha, they have a huge variety of calligraphy, and I'm sure they have some lohas, but I'm going to show you. This is a beautiful piece by Daud Bektash. And this would be a piece written with a kalam, a large kalam, on paper, which is then going to be mounted, and then it's going to be framed to be displayed. And we have huge examples, such as these ones, in the Bursa.
Do you see the little pen? The giant pen he used to write?
Ah, yeah, it's here.
That's it.
That's it. You see, it's here. So this is the kalam that was used to write, because the calligrapher was so proud of the way it's extremely difficult to write at this size, that he displayed the kalam here to show, the incredible feat. This was Abdul Fattah. So these calligraphy panels from the 17th century onwards start being present almost in all, all spaces of the Ottoman society, such as the Sufi lodges, the small neighborhood mosques. This is a very interesting picture from the beginning of the 20th century, and you can see there are little calligraphy panels all over. Wherever there's a space, they would hang it. Yes, and then this is an example of calligraphy. It's not in the Sufi lodge, it's not in the mosque, it's in the home. And this is an interesting example by a private collector where you see calligraphy is displayed very much like a painting. Yes, you have the Western, Orientalist, Impressionist painting, and then you have the calligraphy next to it. So some people would say, oh, well, now it has a decorative role. But I would say no, it goes beyond the aspect of just decoration, because all of these pieces contain Quranic ayats, and they do contain either wise sayings or religious sayings that are meant to be read and are meant to be understood and are meant to be a reminder of the sacred. So that it's actually a very interesting development which continues to this day, and this is what a classical calligrapher today, such as Mohamed Zakariya or Khalid, most of the things we do would be the calligraphy panels. And then, of course, from time to time, if we are lucky enough to have the commission and so on, one could write a book, one could write a Quran. But that would be, let's say, the exception. Another very beautiful, let's say, genre within the calligraphic panel is the hilya, which is, we can describe this as the calligraphic icon of the Prophet. And this is a very beautiful, it contains a hadith that describes the physical attributes of the Prophet. And then there are many variations. Sometimes it has the different names of God, the different names of the Prophet, different descriptions of different prophets like this one. And this one would actually be closed, very much like a Christian icon. And for certain occasions, they would open the hilya, and they would call this ziyaret etmek, you know, they would visit the hilya for certain special nights, and they would light a candle and so on. And this is something which continues to this day in the Islamic world. To have a hilya in the home is considered a huge blessing. It has many talismanic properties as well. And it's a very important aspect of the practice today of the classical school. This is an example just to show you a typical